sitting up for a quiet. That's most rules are gone, and what a wonderful convivial gathering it is here. I'd also like to acknowledge Roger Price, who is our Consul General in Chicago, which also carries responsibilities in this town as well, and to acknowledge his colleague from the Philippines, also Consul General in Chicago. It's the thing which gives this gathering here such poignancy to me is, of course, it's taking place on D-Day. That extraordinary event which began the final process of liberation from tyranny in Europe. And it was moving for me to watch your presence, to see those leaders gathered with you, pay tribute to your greatest generation and our greatest generation too. And it's to appear to be here, not only on this day, but also in the presence of so many of your courageous veterans, just adds to the joy and the sense of privilege that I feel on this occasion. We have a very close relationship with you. You know that. You may not know all the detail of it, but I can assure you that we in Australian political life, we live it from day to day. I have two particular things or events or settings which have been absolutely critical to me, influencing me in my attitudes as a politician in Australia towards the United States. The first of those refers to the progress of events after the Second World War, in which when the numbers of that war were counted, the dead were counted and the veterans came home, America faced a choice. It was possible for the United States, with 55% of world production, with absolute security, having witnessed the complete insanity of Europeans twice over, and also having dealt with the prospect of tyranny in the Pacific, to resort to a degree of personal comfort, security, safety, and a quiet enjoyment of a well-deserved prosperity. United States chose not to. The United States instead decided it would render itself a hostage. It was the beginnings of the nuclear era, and the US decided at that point in time that it would take the risk for freedom, and the risk was that should anyone miscalculate, 140 million Americans would die and this beautiful land would rot. That is a world historical sacrifice. That is a world historical sentiment of unselfishness that no other nation would make sensible, or has regards itself as making sensible calculations, would make that calculation. But you did. And it was not simply a calculation made by your servicemen and women, nor even by your political leadership. It was made by all of you. All of you made that decision to render yourselves hostage to the good behaviour of the maddest places on earth. Now, anyone who sat there and objectively looked at it would have to have the most profound respect for the United States. And so I did, as I operated through a fairly lengthy political career. Second refers to the man and the events that you commemorate here today, this your Memorial Week, and the person of General Douglas Macarthur. And I'll say most of my remarks are going to be directed towards that. The upshot of what he did, the upshot of your sacrifice subsequent to that, is the underpinnings of the strong relationship that we have with you. We have a very intense intelligence relationship, most of which we cannot talk about, but the development of that in the 1960s produced a situation where we agreed to share with you the status of being a nuclear target in order to put in place communication systems and ballistic missile submarines. Early warning, we doubled the facilities in Australia, doubled American early warning times of the Soviet nuclear attack. Given that the distant early warning radar gave you 15 minutes, and launch on warning for the US President was 15 minutes, It was useful with the Australian facilities added 20 minutes to that. So when this from time to time, the Aurora Borealis showed up as a massive Soviet missile attack on the United States, it was possible for you to make corrections on the basis of advice at home. And then the most important and continuing facility was one at Pine Gap. And I can't talk about what it does, but I can say this, that if we put every Australian soldier in Afghanistan, if we put the entire Australian Navy in the Persian Gulf and the entire Air Force at Bagram Air Base, that facility would not perform on a day-to-day basis services as significant for the troops that operate in Afghanistan as is performed by that facility at Pine Gap. That's the status of our military commitment. Where your fourth biggest arms purchaser, 15% of the Australian defence budget, is spent in the United States, and that gives us really absolutely critical capabilities. I might say we're your fourth biggest, but if you count the numbers who actually pay for it themselves, we're about the second or third biggest. And we're also learning now about the investors in the United States. You invest $650 million directly and indirectly in Australia, which is approximately 7 to 10 times what you invest in China. We invest $430 billion in the United States, and that's roughly 20 times what we invest in China. The relationship between us economically is far more intense than we all understand, as we tend to focus on the other big players in the global system. Australia has the third largest sum of money under management globally at $1.9 trillion. That over the next 15 years will go to $5 trillion, and apart from that, which is invested in Australia, the lion's share of that will be invested in the United States. So we will move from about eighth as your investors to a figure very much higher than that. So this is an intense relationship intensified. And where did it begin? Well, it began with General Douglas MacArthur. And it began with a relationship that he established with the then Australian Prime Minister John Kerr. It's 6 degrees of separation. All of us can sit down here at this table, at your table, and after about 6 degrees, you'll find you can connect yourself with the President of the United States or Pope Francis or just about anybody on Earth. 6 degrees of separation. I can do better than that than John Kerr. The only way my parents would allow, my mother would allow me to steal.
This time I'd like to introduce you to a person that's becoming increasingly famous here in the United States. His name is David Black. He's from Curtin University in Perth, West Australia. He's a biographer of Australian Prime Minister John Joseph Curtin. He's become a friend of the War Memorial Center and all of us. And David, this is your fourth and final presentation in Milwaukee. So please join us in welcoming David Black, who will introduce our speaker.
It's my very great pleasure to be able to introduce to you in a moment our guest speaker this evening, the Australian Ambassador to the United States of America, Kim Beazley. Can I just, as a very short background and comment, point out that on the 27th of December in 1941, Prime Minister of Australia, John Curtin, had published in a newspaper his New Year's message to the Australian people. And in that New Year's message, he stated that without any inhibitions of any kind, Australia was going to return to America for help, that Britain would have to look after itself, but that Australia needed and was seeking assistance from the United States. That crucial message began an important phase involving the arrival of General Douglas MacArthur and the cooperation between Australia and America, which led to success and victory in World War II, and led on eventually, subsequently, to the formation of the Australian-American Alliance, which is as strong today, if not more so, than it has been. Now, to talk about Curtin and his role in all of this, and to talk about Douglas MacArthur and his role in this, we are extremely fortunate and extremely privileged to have speaking to us tonight the Australian Ambassador, Kim Beazley. Kim Beazley was a Member of Parliament, the House of Representatives, from 1980 until 2007. He led the Labor Party for several years, and I can tell you, as a political observer, that he came extremely close to becoming Prime Minister of Australia in 2001. Kim Beazley was for 6 years a Minister for Defence, and he's regarded by those who know him well as having a lifelong interest in military and his role and part to play in politics and government of the country. Kim Beazley is a Rhodes Scholar, an extraordinarily well-informed person, and we are extremely fortunate indeed that to have someone in such a high position, someone who very nearly became his country Prime Minister. And can I add as the final marvellous point, if you like, that when John Curtin died tragically in 1945, he was succeeded as member for Fremantle by Kim Beazley's father, also Kim Beazley. So it's in the family, it's in the party, he has all the background. I ask you to welcome Kim Beazley.
Also having dealt with the prospect of tyranny in the Pacific. Mexico's doctor. The United States instead decided it would render itself a hostage. It was the beginnings of the nuclear era, and the US decided at that point in time that it would take a risk for freedom, and the risk was that should anyone miscalculate, 140 million Americans would die and this beautiful land would rot. That is a world historical sacrifice. That is a world historical signal of unselfishness that no other nation would make sensible, or has regards itself as making sensible calculations, would make that calculation. But you did. And it was not simply a calculation made by our servicemen and women, nor even by political leadership. It was made by all of you. All of you made that decision to render yourselves hostage to the good behaviour of the maddest places on earth. Now, anyone who sat there and objectively looked at it would have to have the most profound respect for the United States. And so I did, as I operated through a fairly lengthy political career. Second refers to the man and the events that you commemorate here today. It's your Memorial Week and the person of General Douglas Macarthur. And I'll say, most of my remarks are going to be directed towards that. The upshot of what he did, the upshot of your sacrifice subsequent to that, is the underpinnings of the strong relationship that we have with you. We have a very intense intelligence relationship, most of which we cannot talk about, but the development of that in the 1960s produced a situation where we agreed to share with you the status of being a nuclear target in order to put in place communication systems and ballistic missile submarines. Early warning, we doubled the facilities in Australia, doubled American early warning times of the Soviet nuclear attack. Given that the distant early warning radar gave you 15 minutes and launch on warning for the US president was 15 minutes, it was useful that the Australian facilities added 20 minutes to that. So when this from time to time, the Aurora Borealis showed up as a massive Soviet missile attack on the United States, it was possible for you to make corrections on the basis of advice at home. And then the most important and continuing facility was one at Pine Gap. And I can't talk about what it does, but I can say this, that if we put every Australian soldier in Afghanistan, if we put the entire Australian Navy in the Persian Gulf and the entire Air Force at Baghdad Air Base, that facility would not perform on a day-to-day basis services as significant for the troops that are operating in Afghanistan as is performed by that facility at Pine Gap. That's the status of our military commitment. We're your fourth biggest arms purchaser, 15% of the Australian defence budget is spent in the United States, and that gives us really absolutely critical capabilities. I might say we're your fourth biggest, but if you count the numbers who actually pay for it themselves, we're about the second or third biggest. Which is approximately 7 to 10 times what you invest in China. We invest $430 billion in the United States, and that's roughly 20 times what we invest in China. The relationship between us economically is far more intense than you all understand, as we tend to focus on the other big players in the global system. Australia has the third largest sum of money under management globally at $1.9 trillion. That over the next 15 years go to $5 trillion, and apart from that, which is invested in Australia, the lion's share of that will be invested in the United States. So we will move from about eighth of your investors to a figure very much higher than that. So this is an intense relationship intensifying. And degrees of separation. All of us can sit down here at this table and your table. And after about 6 degrees, you'll find you can connect yourself with the President of the United States or Pope Francis or just about anybody on Earth. 6 degrees of separation. I can do better than that with John Kirk. The only way my parents would allow, my mother would allow me to steal the family car so I could drive to university every day was if I would take her every month down to the Fremantle, a town Australia's port city, where she would pick up Mrs. Curtin, John Curtin's widow, and we'd pick her up from the Curtin household in Morris College in West Australia, and we would drive her each month down to meetings for the Fremantle Labor women. I can claim less of a connection with Macarthur, but I did briefly meet his wonderful wife. We were raising funds at the time for the Curtin Library at Curtin University in Western Australia. It was decided to raise funds here, and she decided, because she loved her time in Australia so much and had such profound respect for John Curtin, that she wanted to lend her name to the fundraising initiative. And it was a privilege to meet her, and she told me something of her time in Australia, where she lived in Brisbane for 2.5 years. She told me about the fact that she lived, like most Australians, in a very egalitarian society, going down to the grocery store and pick up the groceries, dropping in on the neighbours for a cup of tea or a cup of coffee. I mentioned this to the fellow I appointed as Chief of Army in Australia. He said, yes, I, as a boy, I was her neighbour. And I used to play in the backyard with Arthur. In the 2 years that they were there. In Australia, everybody knows everybody, and apparently everybody in Brisbane in those days knew Mrs. Macarthur. So that's a bit of a personal connection. There's another connection for me when I was a defence minister. If you go to Canberra and you look across the lake from Parliament House, you'll see the Russell Office buildings that the original Defence Department Canberra-based buildings. They stand three sides of a square. The middle square of the square is called Wayne's Square. But in the middle of that, there is this enormous cliff, and on top of it, a stylized eagle. And it's stylized in a way that was nicknamed in Australia as Bugs Bunny. But it stands for something far more serious than that. That is not. Australians have fought in 9 wars and in countless peacekeeping operations, both last century and this century. But that is not a memorial to the sacrifices of Australian soldiers, any though those sacrifices have been. There is a beautiful war memorial, the best in the world actually, war memorial museum about 2 miles away from that, which does that in plenitude. But this memorial, in the middle, the Australian Defence Department, above Blakey, who was technically the commander of Australian forces, a square named after him, is a square exclusively, is a plinth and symbol exclusively expressing gratitude to the soldiers of the United States for the roles that they have played in the defence of freedom. And in particular, the 1 million soldiers who passed through Australia in World War II. 1 million, Australian population in World War II was about 7.5 million. It was a close-run thing at different points of time. You all know from your reading of Macarthur's history how he came from Australia, how he exited Matan and Corregidor to do that. What you often don't comprehend is the achievement there and the rationale and the source of importance of his departure from Australia subsequent to that. Near that was the US fought for so long, so outnumbered, and so outgunned. It was a brilliant defence, and it was conducted over a period of time that massively slowed down the Japanese advance. It was so successful that the brutal Japanese commander was sacked at the end of it for the humiliation that he had inflicted upon Japanese arms by the alleged incompetence of the way in which he conducted the fight. He wasn't incompetent. It's just he was up against somebody better. He was up against a better general, and he was up against better soldiers. But it punched a hole in the self-image of the Japanese at that point in time about their invincibility. And I have to say, as an Australian, that the contrast on the other side of the archipelago in terms of performance in no way matched the activity that took place in Bataan and Corridor. So that was a justifiable highlight in Macarthur's reputation. While it might not have been understood everywhere else, it was very well understood in Australia. John Curtin, who was the Australian Prime Minister of the day, insisted to his American and British counterparts that Douglas Macarthur should be withdrawn from the Philippines and brought to Australia to command forces in the Southwest Pacific. As gallant though the defence was, it was obviously going to fail. And the talent of the person concerned could not be forgotten. So much against Macarthur's will, he was dragged out and he was sent to Australia, where he was appointed commander, not simply of American forces in the Southwest Pacific, but he was appointed the commander of Australian forces in the Southwest Pacific. He was the commander of the main Australian military effort in World War II. He was and is a great Australian figure as a result of the things that he did there. It's sometimes portrayed in historiography that there was Australia, weak, exposed, not terribly competent, looking around for saving, found saving Macarthur. That, of course, is complete nonsense. Australia was, by 1941, a battle-hardened nation. We were, the three divisions we had in the Middle East, the go-to boys for every difficult deed in that conflict. Our troops were the ones that had to hold Rommel's advance by hanging on to Tobruk, which we managed to do despite constant assaults on them for a period of about 6 months. When it was decided that Greece would be assisted, it was decided that rather than commit British units to that, the mainland committed Australian divisions. So Australian divisions got thrown into Greece at that point in time. When it was decided to overthrow the Vichy French regime in Syria, far better to use the Australian 6th Division than any of the other units there operating at the time, because we could afford a lack of friendship with the French, and others might not so much be able to do so. Interesting little vignette. You all of you will regret and remember the late Moshe Dayan, that notable figure, and the fact that he was one eye and had a patch over that eye. That was a wound not governed in the 1948 wars in Israel or any of the subsequent conflicts. He got that serving under the Australian Army, because attached to the 6th Division in Middle East in that fight with the Vichy French forces was the British Jewish Brigade, of which Moshe Dayan was a member, and he was wounded in that fight. And I always like to point out to my Israeli colleagues who might be proud of the way they conduct affairs in the Middle East and the value of their troops. In terms of the numbers of soldiers buried in the Middle East, it's going to take, and one hopes they never achieve it, the IDF a long time to catch up with the number of Australians buried there. So we weren't inexperienced. Indeed, we still left goals back. The Australian 9th Division was the division on which the British victory at El Alamein, the first of their victories, pivoted. We supplied 10% of Allied forces in the struggle at El Alamein, and we secured 25% of the casualties. The problem was, for us, we had a desert force, and it was there. We had a Japanese invasion coming down towards Australia through New Guinea and through the Solomon Islands. There's a gap in capability and reorientation in jungle fighting. And there is an American and British agreement that we will be in the first. The implicit assumption that Australia may be committed to go. Curtin understood one thing absolutely. And if anything, the experience he had with the Commodore of the TAB was that the Americans would not let Macarthur go. We needed Macarthur, A, because he was a British general, and B, because the Americans would not want to see him lose. Nevertheless, and I think we probably miscalculated the extent to which the Americans were committed. We weren't aware at the time that Admiral King, who loathed Macarthur, and nevertheless secured an amendment to the meeting with her strategy and had got from the American commanders, the American chiefs and from Roosevelt, a commitment that the US would defend a line from Australia to Hawaii, and they'd defend it not on the basis of defensive operations but aggressive operations to prompt from the Japanese from that point. So what we had at that, as the war proceeded with Macarthur coming to Australia, we had Macarthur with a deliberation on the part, including the Battle of King, that he would be kept short of support, but that he would be kept not sufficiently short, so be in a position in which he would lose. So in 1943, as Macarthur is winning those brilliant victories in the beginning, he actually started in 1942. He had 700,000 Australian servicemen under his command and 200,000 Americans. It was also the case that in every theatre of war, in the Second World War, the Americans supplied themselves and their allies. That included on the Eastern Front, where the Soviet successes against Germany would not have been possible without the transport and logistics infrastructure that the United States provided. That occurred everywhere on the globe except in one place. In one place, American forces were dependent on somebody else to supply. That happened to be Australia. So uniquely, Australia supplied not the pointy stuff, the aircraft, but the basics for fighting the war, supplied the Macarthur with what it was he basically needed for his initial victories. He did a deal ultimately with Roosevelt, and that deal produced for him in the end, for the first time in 1944, more American troops under his command than Australian troops. Even then, he did not get the amount and number of American forces that were assigned to General Mark Clark in North Italy. When you think of the threadbare capacities that were handed across to him, never assigned an aircraft carrier the entire time he was operating in that war, so critical to the United States. What an extraordinary military commander he was. Now, Curtin is sometimes criticised for a variety of things. One of the things that he's criticised for is tending to neglect the Australian commanders in favour of Carver. Well, it has to be said, if somebody came here and said, Prime Minister, you've got a choice here of advisors, General Tom Blaney or General Douglas MacArthur. Selecting MacArthur is a bit of a no-brainer. I have to tell you on that one, to criticise a bloke for deciding to make him your principal advisor is not a criticism based on common sense in my mind. But Curtin was a fellow who had a quite religious, a man of great sensitivity, a man of great affection, a man of quite considerable nervousness and fear about the plights of the soldiers and whether or not they were going to survive at sea, submarine threats and the rest of it. He had an absolutely ruthless view about how you conduct a war effectively and what the sinews of war are required for it. And what advantage, I'm not going to go through too much politics because I think I've actually already spoken well enough, but I do think that it's quite an interesting thing in Australian political history terms. Curtin had, as I said, an expertise in military equipment. He had an interest in looking at it and comprehending it. He had a comprehension of war and war fighting. What he didn't have was a sense of simpatico with the folk who had led the Australian Armed Forces in the period of the 20s and 30s. Mostly of whom were officers that served in World War I, became reserve officers of a larger reserve force. They also associated themselves with very doubtful conservative politics, including some that ended up on the other side of the conflict, if you like, when that ultimately emerged from 1939 to 1945. He trusted Macarthur, he trusted the American commanders, he did not necessarily distrust them, he did trust them, but he was not simpatico with them in the way in which he might have been if he'd been on the more conservative side of politics in that period of time. So that was the ambit in which Australia conducted its relationship with the United States during the course of that war. It would be nice to say that there was, immediately after the war, a reflection of the friendship that they built up at that extraordinary level of American engagement with Australia, and then alliance affairs which immediately after that. The truth is, the idea of imperial defence had a firm grip on the Australian mind. Urgency might have changed in the way David Black read out from Curtin's article in introducing me. But the whole of the sense of being Southern Hemisphere British was enormous on the Australian consciousness. Likewise in the United States, there was a sense that the South Pacific had been at the absolute tail end of a situation of extremity the US never expected to be in again. Therefore, it was North Asia that counted, not South Asia, Southeast Asia. Efforts were made in the late 1940s to put together an alliance relationship that incorporated Australia and the United States. It was vigorously opposed by the American military leadership. And it was opposed on the grounds of the wrong place, irrelevant area, don't worry about it, focus on North Asia, Japan, Korea, or Japan, not yet Korea, Korea was later, was mistakenly ruled out of this year. But that North Asian part, let's focus there, and forget about the Australians. There would have been no Australian-American alliance had there not in the first instance been that experience of collaboration with Macarthur. But in 1951, when Anzus was signed, critical was the effort by the United States to put in place a Japanese peace treaty. The Australian government said to the United States, you will sign a treaty with us or we will not sign a peace treaty with Japan. The Americans said, well, if you put it like that, I guess we'd best do it. Furious the Joint Chiefs were at this piece of backsliding. It is told true that you can expect, unlike NATO, there will be no military planning arrangements in the operations of that treaty. It was an important treaty to us, but mainly our commitments in the 50s were not with the United States, they were in Britain in Malaya, and then ultimately with Britain in Malaysia. Things changed in the 1960s. 2003, the United States decided to engage, and McNamara decided that he needed a triad of nuclear capabilities, and the nuclear capabilities needed to be massively expanded, and as they were expanded, they needed a piece of real estate in which there could be a set of warning communication systems and the like put in place, those systems that I discussed earlier. So really, I suppose you have to say, it wasn't the fact that Carter started the Australian-American Alliance, but McNamara doesn't sound as good. So we'll stick with Macarthur, but McNamara, that era, actually has to be acknowledged. So these are the origins. These are the origins of the relationship between the two countries. Curtin also, at the time, was criticised for being a little too focused or sympathetic to the position of Macarthur on proceeding on to the Philippines without the Australians and leaving the Australians in substantial mopping up operations. I can say I think that's unfair, but it's in fact it's made is a product really of the end of the war before an invasion of Japan. And Japan being invaded and being five Australian divisions ultimately associated with that. And people wouldn't be talking in those terms about that situation. But the matter was there for debate. I have to say, I just want to conclude with a couple of little vignettes that I think basically demonstrate reasonably effectively aspects of the of our relationship with Macarthur at that point in time. The last great amphibious assault of the war in the Pacific was not Okinawa. The last great amphibious assaults are names that you do not be aware of. They are Tarakan and Balikpapan. They were assaults under Martin Macarthur's directions by the Australian Army in the Brunei Borneo area to cut off the oil and colour flight during the submarines, and that was supply of oil from that part of the globe to the Japanese war effort. Macarthur attended both those meetings. They were the last World War II amphibious landings that he attended. He loved Kirk. When Curtin died about the same time as Roosevelt, Macarthur took his pipe, went out onto his veranda of his headquarters, and would not be interrupted for the entire war. He sat there and reflected on his freedom. Curtin was succeeded by a man named Ben Chifley, and the Australians held the card, if you like, for the British Commonwealth. Supervisory body, laughingly termed supervisory body of Macarthur's operation in Japan after the war. My father was by then being elected to Parliament, succeeded Curtin after he died, and he was placed by Chifley on this oversight committee of the Australian House of Representatives, and therefore went to meet Chifley after Chifley was returning from a sojourn in Japan. And Chifley said to Dad, "Kim, what is the difference between General Macarthur and the Japanese Emperor?" My father responded that he didn't know. The Prime Minister said, "The Emperor has renounced his divinity." Minister of Curtin's government asked the then Prime Minister if he'd mind doing about through. Call the speech. Now he is dead. There is neither rank nor prerogative in the democracy of the dead nor the republic of the grave. For us, however, Douglas Macarthur belongs to the immortal dead. But he belongs forever in the hearts and history of the Australian people. In the words of the poet, this country, as does his own, owes him